Hi everybody, and welcome to my first talk for the fourth geometric analysis festival. If I'm going to give you a detailed overview about what I'm going to discuss in the next few talks, let's first have a look at the following formula. So consider a free manifold M and a function U and M. Then the boundary integral involving the mean curvature is equal to the integral over your manifold involving the Hessian of U, the scalar curvature of M, the Gaussian curvature of the level sets, and the Laplacian of U. And the advantage of this formula is that it's really general. It holds true for any function u, and moreover, the scalar curvature appears. So by prescribing the Laplacian of u appropriately, one can get results involving scalar curvature. For instance, one can prove the following statements. One can show the non-existence of matrix with positive scalar curvature on a torus, all kinds of positive mass theorems, the spacetime dihedral rigidity conjecture, and the above formula also includes the monotonicity of the Hawking energy, which then famously led to a proof of the Riemannian Penrose inequality. Today in my first talk, we're going to get started with an introduction of the level set technique, and I do so by giving a simple and elementary proof of the non-existence of a metric of positive scalar curvature on a torus. Then my second lecture, we're going to go to the non-compact setting, studying asymptotically flat manifolds and initial data sets. Moreover, this is going to include proofs of the Riemannian and the spacetime positive mass theorem, which we're going to compare to other proofs of this result. And finally, in my third lecture, we're going to focus on the question, what if we have a result we want to prove involving scalar curvature? What is the best technique to tackle it with? Is it minimal surfaces? Is it spinners or are it level sets? So I'm going to talk a bit about advantages and disadvantages. And then I'm going to give you two examples where it's advantageous of using the level set technique, which includes a convergence result for the Brown-York mass and rigidity of both the spacetime and the hyperbolic team T. Finally, I'm also going to mention a couple of open questions. All right, let's get started. So we have the classical theorem that a free torus does not admit a metric of positive scalar curvature. And this is a well-known statement, which has been proven already some time ago. There's a proof using minimal surfaces by Shen and Yao. Basically, the idea is you use the topology of your torus to get the existence of area-minimizing surface sigma 2. And then because the surface sigma is area-minimizing, you have a second variation formula. And combining this variation formula with the Gauss equations and Gauss-Bonnet's theorem then leads to a contradiction in view of having a PSC metric on a torus. Then there's also another proof by Gromov and Lawson using spinners and the Lichnerowicz formula. And basically both the proofs or the corresponding proof techniques, minimal surfaces and spinners, have been the dominant techniques when studying scalar curvature for the last four decades. However, there's also been a new technique emerging, which has been introduced by Stern 2 years ago, using harmonic functions or harmonic maps. So in this case, we are going to look at a harmonic map U going into S1. And now rather than just looking at a single surface sigma as the minimal surface technique, we're looking at a whole family of surfaces, namely the level sets of U, sigma T. And now let me show you how exactly we proceed to then get a contradiction in view of having a PSC metric. So basically we have three ingredients. The first ingredient is Bochner's formula. Bochner's formula tells us that 1/2 Laplace norm gradient u squared is equal to the Hessian of u squared plus the Ricci curvature of gradient u, gradient u. And now the crucial observation comes. Namely, this Ricci curvature term can be expressed as gradient u squared times the Ricci curvature in the normal direction, where here nu is the normal to our level set sigma t. But this term Ricci nu nu also appears in another formula, namely the Gauss equations. Recall that the Gauss equations tell us that twice Ricci curvature nu nu is equal to the scalar curvature of M minus twice the Gaussian curvature of the level sets plus the mean curvature of the level sets squared and then minus the second fundamental form squared. So then combining both these equations and integrating, we get that zero is equal to the integral over the torus of twice Laplace norm gradient u, which is equal to the integral of the Hessian of u squared divided by the norm of the gradient of u plus the scalar curvature times norm gradient u. And then we also have minus twice integral over the torus of the Gaussian curvature times norm gradient of u. Now the first thing to observe of this formula on the right hand side is that this term over here is going to be positive if you have positive scalar curvature. So all that remains now is to study this Gaussian curvature term, and here we can use the core area formula to see that this term is equal to the integral of S1, the integral over the level sets of the Gaussian curvature. And now we can apply Gauss-Bonnet's theorem to see that this is less or equal than zero. And now combining everything, we see that zero is strictly bigger than zero. So we have obtained a contradiction and we cannot have a metric of positive scalar curvature. So you see that there have been basically three main ingredients. The first one was Bochner's formula. Then we used the Gauss equations and then finally Gauss-Bonnet's theorem. And basically for this level set technique, it's always the same. You combine these three statements and then they give you results about scalar curvature or then also about more general quantities such as the dominant energy condition. I hope you enjoyed my talk. And the next one, we're going to go to the non-compact setting. And I'm looking forward to see you on my next talk. Thanks.